It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Michael E. Mann. Dr. Mann is one of the most important climate scientists on Earth. He's the author of hundreds of scientific papers and multiple books on climate change, including his latest, The New Climate War, The Fight to Take Back Our Planet. Among the numerous awards Dr. Mann has received, I'll just mention a few. He was recently elected to the National Academy of Sciences. He was named by Bloomberg News as one of the 50 most influential people. He was named by Scientific American as one of the 50 leading visionaries in science and technology. Dr. Michael Mann.
Thanks so much, Greg, for the kind words. I would like to talk about this defining challenge that we face and that folks in Arizona are seeing now directly, the impacts of climate change. So I'm going to talk about what I call the new climate wars, the challenges that we face today as the impacts of climate change become obvious to the person on the street and the forces of climate inaction can no longer claim credibly that climate change isn't happening. They have shifted to a new array of tactics in their effort to prevent us from taking the actions necessary to wean ourselves off of fossil fuels. First, I want to talk a little bit about the projections that were made a half century ago, because what's happening now was predicted more than 50 years ago. I'm going to talk about projections that were made back in the early 1980s by ExxonMobil, by a team of scientists from the world's largest publicly traded fossil fuel company, ExxonMobil, where they successfully predicted the warming that we would see by now, back in 1982, under the assumption that we continue to burn fossil fuels for energy. They predicted what the rise in carbon dioxide concentrations would be and what the warming of the planet would be, remarkably well. So they knew what was coming. And in fact, they referred to the impacts of this warming as potentially catastrophic. Those aren't the words of Al Gore. They're not the words of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Those are the words of ExxonMobil's own scientists in the early 1980s. But what did they do? Did they come forward and engage us policymakers? Did they engage the larger community in talking about what we could do to avert this crisis? No. They doubled down in a campaign to deny the threat of climate change, the reality of climate change. They spent tens of millions of dollars attacking climate scientists like myself, trying to undermine public confidence in the science of climate change. And as a result of decades of inaction, due in large part to the efforts by ExxonMobil and other fossil fuel companies to prevent action, we have a much greater challenge on our hands now. If we had acted back a couple decades ago when we already knew we had a problem, as you can see, we could have avoided a dangerous warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius, nearly 3 degrees Fahrenheit, which we're coming close to now. And if we look at the impacts that amount of warming would have, that has led climate scientists to sort of define 1.5 degrees Celsius warming as sort of a level of truly catastrophic warming of the planet. We're getting very close. If we had acted a couple decades ago, we could have brought our carbon emissions down pretty gently, as you can see here, and still avoided warming more than that amount. But what decades of inaction have bought us is a much steeper trip down this slope. If you're a skier, we've gone from a bunny slope to a black double diamond slope. That's what we need to do now if we are to avert warming of 1.5 degrees Celsius. And the impacts, as we've already heard here today, they're not subtle anymore. Every summer, we see new record-breaking temperatures around the world, in the US and Europe, unprecedented heat waves. Last year, we set the record for the warmest temperature ever reliably measured on this planet, not far from where you are in Death Valley, California. To be precise, it wasn't 130 degrees, it was 129.9 degrees Fahrenheit. And that was the highest reliably measured temperature on record. That was last year. We just beat that record. The new record for the warmest temperature ever reliably measured on the planet, the same location, again, not far from you in Death Valley, this year, not 129.9, but 130 degrees. And that's part of a larger trend where, as we've already heard, we see this increase around the world in the frequency and intensity of record heat waves. You take heat, you combine it with a record drought. It's not rocket science. You get these apocalyptic wildfires that we've seen in California, that we've seen in Colorado, that we've seen in Arizona, throughout the Western U.S. in recent years. When I viewed this article on the Washington Post website a couple months ago, this is exactly as this article appeared on my screen. California facing drought crisis as water shortages mount and fire danger escalates. Brought to you by ExxonMobil. You can't make this up. That's actually a screen grab. We're seeing that record heat this summer, this heat dome that we've heard about once in a millennium, once in 2,000 years by some estimates, it shouldn't have happened more often than once in about 30,000 or 40,000 years in the absence of climate change. Because of climate change, it's estimated to be a 1-in-1,000-year event, still a very rare event. Some scientists like myself argue that's because the climate models are still underestimating the way that climate change is impacting the climate system, the way it's impacting the jet stream, leading to these very persistent weather extremes that we've seen in recent summers. The climate models don't quite capture some of the real world processes that are involved. And so they're still underestimating the impact that we are having on these extreme weather events. But that heat dome, it's climate change, which is the title of our op-ed in the New York Times a few weeks ago. There's no question, this is climate change. We wouldn't have seen that in the absence of human caused climate change. And indeed, as this headline in The Guardian says, nowhere is safe. Nowhere is safe. And we've seen that. You've seen that here in the desert Southwest. Again, record heat this summer. And that heat and that drought combining to give you record wildfires here in Arizona and around the Western U.S. So the impacts of climate change are no longer subtle. We're seeing them play out. That's true here in the United States. It's true in Australia, where I spent a sabbatical a year and a half ago as the country was literally burning. This is a scene that some of you may have seen. It's sort of seared in our collective conscience. These blazing wildfires with kangaroos looming in the foreground. That was a year and a half ago, about a half a year ago. This was the scene in the same location, New South Wales, the same state in southern Australia. And your eyes aren't deceiving you. That's a house floating down a river. So we alternate from, one year, unprecedented heat and drought and bushfires blanketing the continent, to unprecedented floods. Now, some of the critics will say, well, you climate scientists, you can't make your minds up. Which is it? Is it heat and drought and wildfire? Is it drenching floods? Well, the reality is that it's both. And this is something that we understand quite well now. Climate change increases extremes at both ends of the scale. And so you do see in many of the same regions more extreme heat and drought and also more extreme flooding. When it does rain, a warmer atmosphere can hold more moisture, so you get more rainfall out of a rain event. And sometimes the impacts are catastrophic, as we've already seen, as we've seen in California, as we've seen in Europe this year, dozens killed in flooding, rainfall not seen in 100 years, at least 100 years. Again, unprecedented events that we predicted we would see if we failed to act. And of course, you've also seen in Arizona, in Flagstaff, there have been these massive floods and they combine with sort of all of this material that's sitting around because of the wildfires. These things combine to give you these catastrophic mudslides. So, the impacts of climate change, they're not subtle anymore. We're seeing them play out in real time, and that's a little more than 1 degree Celsius. We've already seen the impact of 1 degree Celsius. Imagine 4 degrees Celsius, because that's where we could end up if we truly fail to act on this crisis. Now, the reason that we have not acted to the extent necessary, as I already alluded to, is because there has been a campaign waged by fossil fuel interests for decades to discredit the science, to hire front groups and experts who will advocate against taking action, attacking renewable energy, helping elect politicians, almost always on one side of the aisle, the Republican side of the aisle, politicians who are willing to do the bidding of the fossil fuel industry rather than what's right for the people they're supposed to represent. And we've called that the climate wars. Now, 4 years ago, I testified to a House committee hearing. This was a hearing of the House Science Committee chaired by Lamar Smith. Again, the Republicans controlled both the House and the Senate at that time. Lamar Smith was the Republican chair of that committee from Texas, a climate change denier, one of the largest recipients of fossil fuel money in the U.S. House of Representatives. And he held a hearing to call into question the basic science of climate change, to attack, to undermine public faith in the science of climate change. There were three climate change contrarians invited by the majority, which was the Republicans, and one witness for the Democrats. That was me. And I just wanted to play one brief segment from that hearing where I'm speaking to Chairman Smith. I think you'll find it enlightening and a bit amusing.
According to an article that came out a few days ago in the journal Science, Chairman Smith was on record at the Heartland Institute. This is a climate change denying Koch brothers funded outlet that has a climate change denier conference every year. And Chairman Smith spoke at that conference.
Dr. Mann, don't mischaracterize that.
Well, let me finish my...
No, they do not say that they are deniers, and you should not say that they are either.
Well, we can have that discussion. I'd be happy to.
Let me finish my statement. Be accurate in your description.
That's I stand by my statement, but can I finish my point?
I'd like to reclaim my time.
Yes. So he indicated at this conference that he, according to Science, and I'm quoting from them, he sees his role on this committee as to a tool to advance his political agenda rather than a forum to examine important issues facing the U.S. research community. As a scientist, I find that deeply disturbing.
Dr. Mann, who said that?
This is according to Science Magazine, one of the most respected outlets when it comes to science.
And who are they quoting?
This is the author, Jeffrey Mervis, who wrote that article. I'd be happy to send to committee the article.
That is not known as an objective writer or magazine.
Well, it's Science Magazine.
So there you have it. Science Magazine, in the sort of up is down, black is white world of climate change denialism. And again, you know, in the case of climate change, sort of the phenomena of alternative facts and fake news, we were dealing with that decades ago before it became fashionable. The thing is, you know, 4 years later, the evidence is, you know, once again, become so obvious that politicians like Lamar Smith can no longer claim that climate change is a hoax, that it's not happening. But they're still advocating for the fossil fuel industry. They're still doing everything they can to prevent us from moving on, from moving away from fossil fuels towards renewable energy. And so that's what the new climate war is about. It's about the tactics that they're now using. Soft denial. You know, well, we're not denying that climate change is happening. We just don't think it's nearly as bad as those scientists are saying. And there are individuals like Bjorn Lomborg who brandishes a Greenpeace t-shirt to convince you that he cares about the environment, but in fact is just peddling pseudoscience and anti-science and downplaying the impacts of climate change in books, in op-eds that are published in right-leaning newspapers like the Wall Street Journal. There's a whole sort of coterie now of individuals who act as promoters of this sort of soft denialism. Yeah, climate change, you know, we accept the science. Don't call us climate change deniers. We accept the science. But, you know, the impacts aren't going to be a problem. We can just adapt to them. The latest in this seemingly endless procession of contrarian authors who garner attention in the right-wing media. Steve Koonin, who describes himself as a former Obama administration scientist. And that's not true. He wasn't, in any formal way working for the Obama administration. He provided some input on a report at one point, and his input was solicited because they wanted to see what climate change deniers and climate change contrarians might have to say so that they could address those contrarian comments. But he's presented himself as an Obama scientist to convince you that we should really listen to his criticism of the science, when in fact, as we've learned recently, he's a Tucker Carlson scientist. He's a Fox News scientist. He was all along. And often this is used to promote delay. It's not that big a problem. We can just adapt. We can just adapt to the changes that are coming, says Marco Rubio, says the conservative prime minister of Australia, Scott Morrison. Or we can engage in geoengineering. We can shoot particles into the stratosphere, sulfur particles to block some of the incoming sunlight to try to cool the planet back down. We can dump iron into the ocean. We can engage in these unprecedented global interventions with a system that we don't understand perfectly in the hope that we might magically somehow offset the warming effect of increased carbon pollution. And this is very popular with people like Rex Tillerson, the former CEO of ExxonMobil and Donald Trump's first Secretary of State. Bill Gates is a big advocate of geoengineering because he downplays the role that renewable energy can play, that existing renewable energy can play. And this is a recurring theme. You have folks who will try to convince us we're going to need to use geoengineering. We're going to need to use, massive carbon capture, untested new nuclear energy technology. And they advocate for these very risky options because they downplay the role that renewable energy can play now. And in fact, the academic literature is very clear on this. We have the technology now to solve this problem, to decarbonize our economy using existing renewable energy. We don't need to appeal to these fairly dangerous options. The right path forward on climate change is to deploy renewable energy now, to decarbonize our economy now, and to put in place policies that will incentivize that shift. The problem isn't technology, it's having the political willpower. And Bill Gates says that he doesn't know the political solution to this problem. Well, that's an admission that he doesn't know the solution to the problem, because the problem is political at this point. It isn't a matter of technology. We can solve the problem if we choose to. You see deflection, and you'll note some alliteration here. We've got denial, we've got deflection, this series of words that begin with D that describe the different tactics in the new climate war. Deflection, just like the beverage industry decades ago, if you remember the famous Crying Indian ad, as it was called. I grew up watching this ad. I remember it when it was playing. And we thought it was this empowering ad convincing us that we could clean up the pollution if we would just turn our attention to being better stewards of the environment. It turns out it was actually a PR campaign. People start pollution, people can stop it. It was a PR campaign by the beverage industry, by Coca-Cola and the beverage industry, to convince us that we didn't need bottle bills. We didn't need systemic policies that would solve the problem at a systemic level. It would hurt their bottom line. It would hurt their profits. So they wanted to convince us we didn't need bottle bills. We didn't need systemic solutions to the problem. We just needed individuals to pick up their bottle and can waste. And as a result of the very successful nature of their deflection campaign, very few states today, only 13 blue states, 13 fairly deep blue states have a bottle bill. There's no national bottle bill. And one of our other great global environmental crises today is the global plastic pollution crisis. We have the beverage industry and their successful deflection campaign to thank for that. The fossil fuel industry took that rule book, they've run with it, and they've even convinced mainstream news outlets like the New York Times to promote this sort of messaging that the solution to climate change is individual changes in our diet, changes in our vehicles, changes in how we travel, how often we travel, how many children we have. There's a reason that British Petroleum gave us the first individual carbon footprint calculator back in the early 2000s, because British Petroleum and other fossil fuel companies wanted us so focused on our own individual carbon footprint that we failed to notice their carbon footprint. They didn't want policies like carbon pricing, like incentives for renewable energy, like policies to block new fossil fuel infrastructure. They didn't want any of those things that would hurt their bottom line, hurt their profits. So once again, they've tried to convince us that the problem is us. It's just a matter of individual lifestyle change. And they've been fairly effective at getting that messaging out. Look, you know, we should all be the best stewards of the environment we can be. And there's so many reasons that we, should diminish our environmental footprint and our carbon footprint. Often the things that we do to accomplish that save us money, they make us healthier, they make us feel better about ourselves, they set a good example for other people. But we can't allow polluters to convince us that that alone is the solution to the climate problem. You and I, we can't impose subsidies for renewable energy. We can't block new fossil fuel infrastructure. We can't put a price on carbon. Only our policymakers can do that. And we need them to do that. And we need politicians who are willing, once again, to do what's right for us rather than the bidding of polluting interests. Division, another D word, dividing the community of climate advocates so that we don't speak with one voice, using social media to get us fighting with each other, often about our lifestyle choices, getting people finger pointing at each other. Why aren't you a vegan? Why do you still fly? Why do you have children? Why have you chosen to have children? If they can get us fighting with each other and behavior shaming each other, it's a great way to divide the community. And they've been very effective at doing that, particularly online, using troll armies and bot armies. Now, sometimes something comes along that it's hard to make sense of. You know, why did Michael Moore, this progressive filmmaker, make a movie that was basically an attack on renewable energy, that was a gift to the fossil fuel industry, that went after the main solution to decarbonizing our economy, renewable energy? I don't know why he chose to do that. I don't know why Michael Moore chose to, maybe he thought that it would get more attention. It's a man bites dog story. Liberal filmmaker, makes movie criticizing the renewable energy industry. Maybe that'll garner more media attention. Well, he did get media attention and he did get promotion. There were a number of organizations and media outlets promoting the film, but they were all right-wing disinformation enterprises like the Heartland Institute, which is a Koch Brothers and fossil fuel industry funded group, the Competitive Enterprise Institute, Koch Brothers, fossil fuel funded, Breitbart News, the Murdoch media empire. That's who was promoting his movie. So that tells you something. They loved the narrative of, eco-leftists are suddenly turning on Michael Moore, divides the community, gets us fighting with each other, and it seeks to discredit their main competitor, the main competitor to the fossil fuel industry, renewable energy, the renewable energy industry. part of that division effort involves attacking opinion leaders, thought leaders, influential individuals in the movement like John Kerry, our special envoy on climate under Joe Biden, going after him, targeting him, attacking him for, you know, supposedly being a hypocrite because he still flies on planes. It's a way of discrediting important messengers in the climate movement. It's a way of dividing the movement, and it's a way of deflecting attention once again away from the needed systemic solutions to the idea that it's just about individual lifestyle and individual behavior. And it's no mystery why the Murdoch media empire has been promoting those attacks on John Kerry. Finally, there's doomism. Ironically, if they can lead us, if the forces of inaction can convince us it's too late to do anything about the problem, it potentially leads us down the same path of inaction as outright denial. And so they do promote doom and gloom and this idea that it's too late. And what's so tragic about that is that many, you know, good people, people of good intentions, people who would otherwise be on the front lines demanding action, become convinced that it's too late to do anything, and they disengage. And that's a win for the inactivists. When, you know, climate when folks who might otherwise be on the front lines advocating for climate action are led to disengage because they believe it's too late, they disengage from the political process. They no longer participate in the larger conversation. Again, that's a big win for the forces of inaction. So let's be aware that doomism, while many people we know who are good people, who are good-hearted, well-intentioned, they fall victim to this. Let's help them out of it, because the science tells us that it isn't too late to act. They need to understand that that's what the science says. We need to get them engaged again and on the front lines with the rest of us, demanding action. So winning the war, well, it's about urgency and agency. Yes, we have a crisis on our hands, but we can do something about it. Yeah. The climate crisis is more deadly than the COVID-19 crisis. While understandably a lot of focus is on the coronavirus crisis, this global health crisis, we will get past it. A year or two down the road, it will largely be in our rearview mirrors, and yet the climate crisis will still be there. And the climate crisis is already more deadly than the coronavirus crisis. And it will be far more deadly. Far more lives will be lost due to climate inaction than were lost due to the pandemic if we fail to take meaningful action. So the agency, we have the solutions, as I said before. We don't need a miracle, Bill Gates. Yeah, he's said we need a miracle to solve the climate crisis. We don't need a miracle. We don't need some magic new technology. We just need the political willpower, and we need politicians, once again, who are willing to do what's right for us. And these days, that's almost exclusively the party that I'm speaking to tonight, the Democratic Party. There is only one party in this country that recognizes the climate crisis, that's willing to do something about the climate crisis. You've got to vote for Democrats. And you've got to help the Pima County Democrats and Arizona Democrats, because this is truly a battleground state. This is where the battle is being waged right now in this state. And we need to recognize that, and we need to rise to the challenge, because nothing less than the future of this planet is at stake. But look, the solution's there. Renewable energy is already cheaper than fossil fuel energy on a levelized basis, despite the claims that it'll be too expensive to switch to renewable energy, to move towards renewable energy. It's actually already cheaper in most markets, and that's becoming more and more true with each passing year. And that's not even taking into account the damage that fossil fuel burning is doing to the planet. And we're seeing, you know, amazing increases in the deployment of renewable energy around the world, in the United States, in Australia, where I was on sabbatical. The wind and solar boom is here. It's happening. The transition is happening. It's not happening fast enough for us to avoid warming the planet beyond dangerous levels without accelerating the transition. So we have to accelerate the transition that's already underway. And that means policies, that means carbon pricing, that means renewable energy portfolio standards, as Democrats are arguing needs to be in this new stimulus package, this infrastructure package. It means blocking new fossil fuel infrastructure. We're turning the corner. Carbon emissions have flattened. In fact, last year, and we know that that's happening because of renewable energy, the IEA, International Energy Agency, which has been very conservative on this front, has said that carbon emissions have plateaued now because of the increasing market share of renewables, far more added capacity each year now in renewables than in fossil fuel energy. But flatlining isn't enough. We've got to bring, as we saw at the very beginning of this lecture, we've got to bring those carbon emissions down by a factor of two within the next decade and down to zero by 2050. And that means, once again, we have to speed up that transition. We did see a 7% drop in global carbon emissions last year. And if we could keep that up for the next 10 years, we would be on that path to keeping warming below 1.5 degrees Celsius. We would be on the path to cutting carbon emissions in half in a decade. The problem is that many of the factors that led to that drop last year were temporary. Social distancing dropped, a very large drop in transportation, measures that were temporary. And we're already seeing those carbon emissions come back. Much of that 7% was offset by a 5% rise so far this year. And what that tells us is that these sort of lifestyle changes aren't going to get us there. We need a fundamental remaking of our global energy economy. We need a structural transition off of fossil fuel burning. Why am I optimistic that we really do have a chance to do that? Again, you look at the conservative IEA, an International Energy Agency, just a couple months ago said, look, it's still possible. We can get to net zero by 2050, which gets us on that path, which keeps us on that path. But there can be no new oil, gas, or coal development, no new fossil fuel infrastructure. Full stop. Good news, the U.S. is back in a leadership position on this issue. The U.S. has made a bold pledge to cut its carbon emissions in half by 2030, which again keeps us on that path that we need to be on. And most importantly, we have reasserted leadership on this issue. It's putting pressure on other actors. China is now back at the table. Other countries are putting forward very bold pledges as we go into the next major climate conference later this year in Glasgow, COP26. But we still have to put pressure. Australia is still intransigent in terms of their commitments. China has still not put anything on the table anything formal on the table. And they are the largest carbon emitter today. And so it's really critical that we use all of the diplomatic tools that we have available to us to bring other countries along. And the U.S. is now doing that under the Biden administration. Elections do have consequences. We couldn't have afforded another Trump presidency. It would have been game over for the climate. I said that many times, but we averted that particular crisis and elected Democrats, not just to the presidency, but to both houses of Congress. And we've got to take advantage of that because we don't have time to waste. There have been some successes recently. Just to review those again. I meant to stop. Sorry about that. The G7 countries a few weeks ago agreed to end support for coal production. That's a really important move on the part of many of the world's largest industrial economies. Royal Dutch Shell was ordered to cut their carbon emissions by 45% by a Dutch court. ExxonMobil had several climate-friendly people, individuals, who were elected to their board of directors just a couple months ago. And that is likely to have a huge impact on the direction that they take with their policies in the years ahead. And the Keystone XL oil project has been abandoned, and in part because the Biden administration signaled that they were not going to greenlight that project. That drove investors away from it, and investors are moving away from investment in fossil fuels. And so there's some real movement there as well. Reasons for cautious optimism, none more significant than the children of the world, the youth climate movement, which has really recentered this conversation where it needed to be all along. This isn't just about science, economics, politics, and policy. It's about ethics. It's about what sort of world we want to leave behind for our children and grandchildren. Now, one possible world is a world where there are no polar bears. There are no more, there is no more Great Barrier Reef, the coral reefs, the great coral reefs of the world. And those are just symbolic of a fundamentally degraded planet with less food, less water, less space, and a growing global population. That's a prescription for, you know, a dystopian Hollywood film. That's one possible future, but we still have time to make sure that that isn't our legacy, that that isn't our future. It's up to us, and this truly is our moment. So I will leave it there. Happy to take some questions from the audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mann. We have a few questions, so that's great. First, Gail asks, our utility regulators have recently approved a 2070 goal for zero fossil fuel energy. How much sooner should that happen to avoid catastrophe?
Yeah, so, and I heard the commissioner talk about that. Commissioner Kennedy, I appreciated her comments on that earlier. And I understand that there's some real politics here. You have to get what you can. And sometimes, you know, in red and purple states, you know, where it's still a challenge to get the sorts of policies passed that we would like to. So 2070, as the commissioner alluded to, isn't nearly as bold a pledge as you'd really like to see. As I said, globally, we have to bring our carbon emissions down to net zero by 2050. And so if Arizona is saying, well, we're going to do it at 2070, well, then they're not quite keeping up their end of the bargain. But understand, you know, again, there's some real politics. We have to get what we can right now. And this is why we're all here, because you get the policies that you get when you elect the politicians that you elect. And if we want to see more political will to take bolder action here in Australia and elsewhere, we clearly need to elect more Democrats. And so it really drives home the point that, you know, to get the policies we need politicians who are willing to do what's right by us, rather than just being those politicians who are a rubber stamp for the fossil fuel industry. So 2070, we need to do better than that. We need to do better than that as a country. And the US's pledge as a country is to get emissions down to net zero by 2050. But it's great that we've seen some movement in Arizona. Let's elect more Democrats so we can get more movement.
Great, thank you. Katie asks, do you believe a national grid can successfully move solar power from massive solar farms to the users, or will we need to rely primarily on local and individual solar panel arrangements?
That's a great question. And here I'm proud to say that I am an all of the above advocate. And when I say all of the above, I don't mean coal and oil and fossil fuels along with renewable energy. I mean all of the ways that we can deploy renewable energy and clean energy. And in some cases, you know, smart grids are going to be part of the solution, and smart large-scale grids that can balance the load from different sources of renewable energy, because the sun isn't always shining. The wind, as we all know, isn't always blowing. We need, you know, improved battery technology and energy storage technology. And so there's a wonderful plan. It's called the Climate Solutions Plan, been developed by folks at Stanford University, Mark Jacobson. And there's a plan for every state, including Arizona, that sort of details, based on the particular mix of options you have, geothermal, solar, wind, particular pathways to reaching 80% renewable energy by 2030 and 100% renewable energy by 2050. And in some cases, it's going to be sort of a distributed, individual, small-scale solar farms, rooftop solar. In some places, it makes sense to provide incentives to the grid, and renewable energy portfolio standards do that. They require utilities to meet a certain percentage. The $35 trillion infrastructure package that's being debated right now in Congress. Right now, there's a renewable energy portfolio standard that would require require utilities to provide 80% of their energy from clean sources by 2030. And so then you allow the utilities to figure out how to do that. And we let the market figure out what combination of individual rooftop solar, distributed energy, wind, large-scale solar farms. Again, all of these will be, you know, part of the solution. There's no one-size-fits-all. So I'm all of the above, but when I say all of the above, I mean all of the ways that we can decarbonize our energy infrastructure, both in terms of the large-scale grid and in terms of increased reliance on distributed, local energy production and storage.
Fantastic. Thank you. Paul asks, would you suggest, as Sandra Kennedy mentioned earlier, that a just transition is a critical part of our timely action in adopting renewable energy?
Yeah, and there, no question. I mean, you know, the people who have been most impacted are the ones who've had the least role in creating the problem. And that's true internationally, the developing world, that, you know, has provided, you know, where carbon, you know, the carbon footprint is orders of magnitude smaller than it is in the industrial world. And yet, you know, the tropics and the global south are seeing some of the worst impacts of climate change, coastal flooding. They have the least resilience because there's the least wealth and the least infrastructure to insulate themselves from the damaging impacts of climate change. We've seen, you know, just this last week, devastating floods through the streets of Europe that have decimated villages and that have, you know, killed a large number of people, nearly 1,000 people, I think, still lost in those floods who haven't yet been recovered. And that's in some of the most, you know, technologically advanced countries in the world. So you can imagine what it's like for a small village in rural, parts of Africa, where they don't have that infrastructure, and they're even more vulnerable to these increased weather disasters. So there's a huge issue of sort of equity and justice, climate justice. And that's true at the international level. It's true in the intergenerational sense, as I alluded to. Those who had the least role, future generations who had no role in creating this problem, are the ones who are going to see the worst impacts. Our children, who, you know, at this point, you know, they can't even vote, and yet they see that their future is threatened by the actions that we are or are not taking today. And then finally, you look at the communities in the United States. In many cases, fossil fuel energy, coal burning power plants are often in low-income areas, and so the people there suffer the air quality and the water quality degradation from our reliance on dirty fossil fuel energy, coal, natural gas. So there are so many levels on which this is ultimately an issue of justice, and that's why we talk about climate justice as a defining principle in how we go about acting and the policies that we put in place. And one thing that was great to see with the, you know, the executive actions that were put forward by the Biden administration earlier this year, climate justice is very much at the center, providing resources to frontline communities to help them deal with the lasting legacy of dirty fossil fuel pollution, providing funding for a civilian climate corps to hire people to actually clean up the damage that's been done in the past. And I think something like a guarantee that 45%, I think, of the funding that this administration wants to provide in their green energy stimulus is going to be directed towards frontline communities. And so, yes, climate justice is a critical component of the solution. And it's good to see that it really is being taken into account by this administration. Again, if you care about this problem, if you care about climate justice, there is only one party that has any interest in your concerns, and that is the Democratic Party.
Thank you. All right, next up, Dawn asks, do carbon offsets deliver any real climate benefit, or are they another form of distraction / diversion?
Yeah, it's a great question. And the answer to that question has evolved a bit, and it's nuanced, frankly. There are a lot of bad offsets out there. You know, you buy an offset, it's really cheap. Hey, you know, it only cost me this to offset my carbon emissions from this flight. Well, you know, who is that airline, contracting out to? Is it a legitimate operation? Is it, tree plantations, for example, where there's unlikely to be any permanent carbon burial, that the carbon that goes into planting these trees is soon lost because of the short generational time scale of these farms? Is this real long-term carbon burial? Are we talking about, old growth forests? You really have to look at the details. And the fact is that there are some legitimate carbon offset programs out there, legitimate entities that do this, but it's going to be more expensive because they try to do it credibly and they try to do it right. That having been said, it's really a last resort. We'd much rather not burn the carbon and put the pollution into the atmosphere than have to offset it, because offsets are always going to be uncertain and imperfect. So my view is that, yes, do some research. If you're forced, if you forced to travel right now, there are certain sectors of the economy where ultimately we will be able to decarbonize them, but it's going to take a little longer. And aviation is a great example of that. We've got to come up with, synth fuels and high density biofuels and better battery technology. And we're working on all that, but it may be a decade or two until we really have viable carbon-free air travel. And if you're forced to, to engage in air travel, and many of us are, then it's certainly better to try to offset those emissions. And when you do try to offset them, try to make sure that the entity that you're using is credible, that the offsetting really is done in a reliable and viable way, because there are some, fly-by-night operations where it's very cheap, but that's because, you get what you paid for. But there are other sectors, cement production. There's some hard to decarbonize sectors of the economy. And there, I think that offsets are going to be important, at least in the near term. So we shouldn't write them off. We shouldn't take them off the table. But we should understand that it's always better to not burn the carbon in the first place, if that's a possible option for you.
Thank you. Gail has another question, asking, what part do insurers and reinsurers play in pressuring companies to do better?
Well, they play a really important role. The reinsurance industry really, for a while, it's sort of been a battle of the titans, because the fossil fuel industry, of course, has done everything they can to block meaningful climate action. But the reinsurance industry understands that climate change is hurting their bottom line. They're paying out larger and larger premiums, you know, with increased coastal damage. You know, the reinsurance, they're the ones who insure the insurers. So they're the ones who really lose out when there is a devastating, you know, hurricane that, you know, and in fact, over the last several years, there have been more than a dozen $1 billion or greater extreme weather disasters in the United States that have certainly been substantially worsened by climate change. And so there's this huge cost. The reinsurance industry, and to an extent, the insurance industry has had to pay that cost. And so they've been a real ally, frankly, as increasingly are some of the investment firms. In the world of finance, there's an increasing recognition that fossil fuel companies are a bad long-term investment because we're going to have to leave their main assets stranded. They're going to have to leave most of the carbon in the ground. If you believe that we're going to take action, and the smart money is on us taking meaningful action over the next decade, then fossil fuels are now a bad investment. And we're seeing investors and you know, major investment banks, we're seeing the finance community start to pull out. There's another component here, which is that, you know, if you are, for example, there are fiduciary funds, retirement funds, et cetera, where, you know, the investor has a real obligation to, you know, not hurt the interests of their client. And if you're destroying the world, you know, if the actions of an industry is really fundamentally degrading, you know, the quality of our life and threatening, you know, future generations, you're not doing right by your client, and it's not consistent with fiduciary responsibility. And so you are seeing, you know, some really interesting discussions. Bank of England, BlackRock, one of the largest investment firms in the world, finance firms in the world, you're seeing them start to pull out of investing in new fossil fuel infrastructure. And to some extent, as I argue in the new climate war, they're actually somewhat ahead of the policy community. So, you know, it's possible that the private sector may get ahead of the, you know, the government sector when it comes to disinvesting in fossil fuels and helping wean us off of fossil fuels. We're going to need the business community, including the investment community, to be on board. They're an important potential ally.
Awesome. Thank you. Next, Barbara asks, what do you know about the rapidly evolving fossil fuel non-proliferation treaty globally? How successful will you be with this type of approach?
Well, let me just say generally that I think, you know, civil engagement, collective action is really important. That's what the youth climate movement has been about. That's what these pipeline protests in the United States have been about. And they've had a real impact. That's what the divestment movement, I think you're sort of alluding to here, that, you know, this movement to ask, you know, companies, individuals, and civic organizations to pull out of, you know, pull their investments out of the fossil fuel sector, mutual funds, asking banks, Rockefeller Brothers Fund, which is the legacy of, you know, the Rockefeller, the legacy of ExxonMobil, the Rockefeller family, the Rockefeller Family Foundation a few years ago announced that they were divesting of any holdings in fossil fuel stocks. And that they represent the legacy of the Rockefeller family and ExxonMobil. So that was a really strong statement. So the divestment movement, pipeline protests, youth climate activism, marches, demonstrations, all of these things have brought pressure on our politicians. I would argue that this sort of grassroots pressure within the Democratic Party, these grassroots efforts on the part of youth, on the part of frontline communities, put a lot of pressure on the incoming president to take a much harder line on climate than anybody thought he was going to take. And if it had not been for those protests and for those demands and for the political action that was being taken by climate action, climate justice groups, I don't think we would have seen the remarkably bold agenda that we've seen from this administration. And so make no mistake, a lot of the policy progress that we're seeing right now, at least from on the executive side, is a direct consequence of the grassroots pressure that was brought to bear during the election, and that continues to be brought to bear. And so my short answer is yes, these efforts are essential. They put pressure on politicians to do the right thing because we know there's an immense amount of money and pressure on them to do the wrong thing.
Fantastic. Thank you. Another attendee asks, does the ocean warming and acidification threaten the ocean's role as our planet's oxygen factory? What's the research on that?
Yeah, so oxygen is less of a problem. Scientists who study sort of the biogeochemistry that's involved. Climate change doesn't really threaten the oxygen supply. We'll still have oxygen, but it hardly matters whether you have oxygen if you don't have an otherwise livable planet, which is to say, if, in the worst case scenario, business as usual carbon emissions, where we see, dramatic flooding of our coastlines and withering droughts and heat within the tropics that makes the tropics essentially unlivable. So now you have this smaller and smaller amount of livable area on the planet for a growing global population. You've got less fresh water and you've got less food, and the ocean will be less productive because as you warm up the oceans, the oxygen, the dissolved oxygen concentration goes down. And this is part of why we see fish species, cold water fish species starting to migrate poleward because the mid-latitude waters that they're used to occupying are too warm for them. They don't hold enough oxygen, and these fish need a large amount of oxygen. So you see salmon, you see lobsters, for example, migrating north in the North Atlantic. And increasingly, you'll have this large dead relatively anoxic zone in the ocean in the tropics and into the mid-latitudes, which would be devastating. So we'll still have atmospheric oxygen to breathe. There's really no reason to believe that we'll see a fundamental change in the amount of oxygen in the atmosphere, but we'll have huge anoxic zones in the oceans combining with the effects of ocean acidification, which you mentioned. Increased CO2 in the atmosphere diffuses into the ocean. There's increased CO2 in the ocean. And that literally, dissolves the skeletons of calcareous organisms, shellfish and crustaceans, corals. So we'll still have oxygen to breathe, but that isn't much of a consolation if we don't have a livable planet in the first place. And so in a worst case scenario, where we allow the planet to warm up 4 to 5 degrees Celsius, 7 to 9 degrees Fahrenheit, twice that much in the polar regions, which will warm up more and faster. That, as I said before, that's a post-apocalyptic dystopian future that we don't want to see. That is one possible future, but we can still take the actions necessary to make sure that isn't our future.
Perfect. Thank you. Michael asks, is there any truth to the Michael Moore documentary?
Is there any truth to it? His name is Michael Moore. That was truthful. It was fundamentally, the very premise of it is false. And in my Newsweek piece, which you can find online, I think, unfortunately, Newsweek is now behind a paywall. It didn't used to be behind a paywall. So that article might be behind a paywall. But in my Newsweek article, which I briefly showcased here in my presentation, I go into some amount of detail, and I link to a number of other analyses by people like Bill McKibben, Leah Stokes, who's an energy expert at UC Santa Barbara. There were a large number of pieces written by people who were really informed about sort of issues of energy economics and environmental sustainability. And, you know, Here is the element, without being glib, there is one element to the film that I agree with, which is that we have to have a larger conversation about environmental sustainability. The climate crisis, this is something where we have to act now or it will be too late to avert catastrophic impacts. And that means decarbonizing our economy. And realistically, we're going to need options to replace fossil fuel energy. And that's renewable energy right now. In the long term, we would like to get away from an extractive economy and a constantly growing economy. And there's an argument to be made that a forever expanding global economy and increased resource extraction and depletion is fundamentally incompatible with a sustainable existence on this planet. We have finite resources. We can't have larger and larger numbers of people extracting more and more resources. And that's really important because sometimes this is diverted to conversations about population. And yeah, population is part of it. But the problem right now isn't the third world. The resource, you know, use among people in the global south, as I said before, orders of magnitude less than the resource use by those of us in the industrial world. And so what we can't have is larger and larger industrial economies using more and more resources. It's a truism. It's obvious that that is incompatible ultimately with a sustainable existence on this planet. And so I do think that we have to have that larger conversation. We do have to have a conversation about how we move away from a global, you know, extractive, resource-driven economy. And that means we can't produce an infinite number of solar panels and wind turbines. In the end, we've got to find a way to live sustainably on this planet. And that would be the one message where I do think the movie has a point. But by really, the movie's quite disingenuous in the way that it misrepresents where we are right now with renewable energy and the way that it tries to imply a sort of a false equivalence that somehow renewable energy does as much damage to the planet as fossil fuel energy by any reasonable metric. And I go through it in my article, and other people who wrote about this do as well. The environmental impact of renewable energy is orders of magnitude smaller than the environmental impact of fossil fuel energy. So that's the most important point. But, you know, but there is a point here that Michael Moore makes about us ultimately needing to find a way to live sustainably on this planet. No question about that.
Thank you, Dr. Mann. We've got four questions left. How are you feeling?
What, can we do a rapid round here? We'll do a yeah.
Michael again asks, our friend Bruce Logan at Penn State has developed the energy IQ based on the quote D factor. How important is energy intelligence / education? And are you guys at Penn State planning to get with Milton Bradley to create a board game to teach the D factor?
So I'm not too sort of involved with that particular effort, But I do know the individual that you named is a colleague and a friend of mine, and we're definitely both in agreement that energy intelligence is really important. It's something we work at here at Penn State. We try to make sure that our students you know, are equipped to understand basic issues of energy economics and sustainability. And there's a huge sustainability institute here at Penn State that works to inform discussions on campus about energy and resource sustainability. And so, yeah, you know, I'm all for making sure that our students and our citizenry in general are as informed about these issues as they can possibly be, because an informed electorate hopefully makes informed decisions and elects politicians who are willing to do what's right rather than what's expedient.
Great, thank you. Kate asks that CCL is all in on carbon fee and dividend. But then I heard Gina McCarthy say she doesn't think it's a good answer, and it's not fast enough. What say you?
Yeah, you know, I've never understood that argument that you hear that. Oh, it's a false argument. It's one that I address in my book, this idea that a carbon tax or carbon pricing isn't fast enough. That all depends, first of all, on the size of the tax. If it's a very small tax, it's not going to change things very much. If it's a larger tax, then it's going to disincentivize fossil fuel, you know, energy pretty quickly. But the other fallacy is the idea that that would be the only tool, the idea that if we were to put a price on carbon, that's all we're doing. Of course, that's not all we're doing. It's just one tool in the toolbox, and we're going to need to use all of them. We need carbon pricing, and that could be a carbon tax. It could be a revenue neutral fee and dividend system like CCL advocates for. I think that's a great option. I think all these options should be on the table. Cap and trade systems are also a viable way to price carbon. These renewable energy portfolio standards are a great option as well. So let's use all of the tools in the toolbox, because we're going to need them all. But let's not create the straw man that somehow any one of them needs to solve the problem on its own, because that's not the way it's going to happen. It's going to happen because we're using all of these tools simultaneously. And carbon pricing is a critical tool, and it should be on the table. And if I were going to criticize this administration, I would say that perhaps for political reasons, they've veered away from the carbon pricing as something that they're focusing on. And I do think that it's something that we need to keep on the table. And I think it's great that CCL and other organizations are working hard to sort of promote these potential tools in decarbonizing our economy.
Great, thank you. What do we do about countries like India, who are moving in opposite directions and meeting in energy demands of their expanding economy by building hundreds of coal-fired power plants?
Yeah, so we have to make sure, and that's what these negotiations right now are about, the negotiations taking place as we go into the next major climate conference. And this was part of the discussion at the G7. Was, you know, the importance of us providing financing and other incentives to developing nations, because we can't afford for them to make the same mistake that we made. You know, we relied on dirty fossil fuel energy for two centuries, and we created this massive problem. We can't afford for them to go through that stage. We need to make sure that it is, you know, that what is, that the option, you know, that what is best for us as a planet is also the option that is best for them. We have to make sure that there are incentives for them to leapfrog past the fossil fuel stage. It's sort of like, you know, if you're, you know, kids today don't learn how to use an abacus. We don't say you need to use an abacus and then a slide rule and then a 1970s calculator. And then eventually, if you do all that, we'll let you use a computer. No, we leapfrog to the technology that exists today because it's so much more efficient. It's so much better. We need to make sure that the developing world does the same thing, because renewable energy technology, clean energy technology is a much better option. It can be distributed. It doesn't require a huge very vulnerable energy grid like fossil fuel energy does. There's so many reasons for these developing economies to leapfrog past that stage directly to renewable energy, but we have to make it advantageous for them to do that, because it's tempting for them to use cheap, dirty fossil fuel energy to grow their economy like we did ours. We need to make sure that there are incentives for them to use better options. And that's what, you know, one of the main discussions was at the G7 summit a few weeks ago, was the major industrial economies of the world. It's in our best interest to make sure that it is in their best interest to skip past the fossil fuel stage.
Thank you. All right, we've got, I think, one more here, but I also was heard we might have some questions live in the room there at headquarters. So I wanted to give anyone there the opportunity to ask a question before we wrapped up, maybe with the last one or two here.
Whoever wants to ask a question, if you could stand up and come over here and speak towards this direction. Anyone?
Okay.
Oh, he already got yours?
Basically with India, one line was about China.
Okay.
Actually, I do have
okay. Come hither.
In front of the thing, speak into it?
Yes.
Yeah, between the flag and the letter.
Yeah,
there we go. Okay.
There you go.
All right. Hi, Dr. Mann.
Hello.
My question is related to looking at conservative politics globally. Do you see, there's a recent report saying that the numbers among Republicans in the United States, younger Republicans, were starting to move away from traditional anti-climate change, climate change. Obviously, the Republican Party is not going to come and, you know, embrace climate change as a significant issue like we have. Do you see a probable path on the international stage for what the Republican Party could look like? So, for example, a country where the conservative party maybe 20 years ago looks like what the conservative party in this country does now. And what does that kind of tell us about how we need to market the need and the, you know, the absolute need to do stuff, to you know, take actions like what you just said the last hour and a half to make those changes now?
Yeah, so thanks for the question. So, you know, there is some movement among younger conservatives. I talk about this in the book. Under 40 Republicans overwhelmingly accept and recognize climate change as a problem. They want to see their politicians doing something about it. So the writing is sort of on the wall, in a sense, for Republicans. They can't continue to deny the climate crisis and get people to vote for them. But, you know, that those sort of demographic changes play out over a decade or more. And we need action now, right? We need to make sure that Republicans aren't able to block climate policies right now, because we've got to bring carbon emissions down by a factor of two, as I said before, within the next decade. And so we can't wait for these sort of generational shifts to take hold. Which means that to some extent, Democrats may have to go it alone in the near term. And that's probably what we're looking at with this reconciliation package, where, you know, the part that's going to pass with a bipartisan coalition isn't going to have any climate measures in it. And the part that's going to have climate measures is going to be the, you know, the Democratic only plan that will pass through reconciliation. So for the time being, I would say we're pretty much looking at Democrats going it alone and taking advantage of the moment that they have to get some meaningful climate legislation passed. But as I say in the book, I do think that there is this shift underway. I don't think Republicans as a party can continue to hold out, and we have seen some evolution, and I detail that evolution where, you know, they've moved away from denial. There's still soft denial and these other tactics that we talked about that are often, you know, that we often see employed by Republicans. But there are an increasingly large number of Republicans who have said, no, look, we've got to get serious about this. We need to put some policies on the table, because if we don't put forward some serious solutions, then we're not really going to have a say in the policies that ultimately get enacted. And so I do think that there's a, there's that small, fairly quiet minority of Republicans who really do want to join with Democrats on climate legislation, but are afraid to do so right now because of the, you know, just the toxic atmosphere that exists in the Republican Party right now. We may have to wait for, you know, the veritable lancing of the boil for whatever this malady that has infected the Republican Party for, you know, for that to play out. We're not really going to know what the playing field looks like on that side of the aisle, probably for a couple of years. We have to see if this Trump sort of fever breaks. And if it doesn't break, then, you know, it will continue to be the case that only one party will be capable of acting meaningfully on the climate crisis. And we know which party that is. It's the party that I'm talking to here tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Mann. I believe we have maybe one more question. And Paul asks, how reliable of an ally or role will the U.S. military be in effectively persuading American business leaders that climate change mitigation is critical?
Yeah, the military has been a really important factor here. Of course, during the Trump years, many of the, you know, the many within our military community were sort of afraid to talk about climate because they knew it was off limits with the Trump administration. But quietly, they were doing everything they could to make sure that some of the basic plans that the military has in place move forward, because they recognize that, you know, on a number of levels. First of all, you know, the greatest national security threat that we face in the years ahead is from climate change. It's what they call a threat multiplier. In fact, I believe Greg referred to this in his comments earlier this evening. It's a threat multiplier because it takes existing competition for food and water and space, basic resources, and it increases that competition, and that leads to conflict. We know that the Syrian uprising, the emergence of ISIS as a global threat was tied to climate-related factors. An epic drought in Syria that forced rural farmers into the cities where they were competing for space and food and water, and that led to increased competition and conflict. And in that environment of conflict, that's when terrorist organizations have a real opportunity to recruit people. And our national security community understands that. They understand that an open Arctic Ocean, you know, without sea ice in the summer, represents a whole new set of challenges in terms of defense of new coastlines, Arctic coastlines. So our national security community gets it. They had to take a subterranean approach during the Trump years, but now in the Biden era, we're seeing now a reemergence of these discussions, and we're seeing the national security community once again engaging on something that they do see as an existential crisis, the climate crisis.
Thank